then after that, the rear brakes, the pistons were, one of them was seized. Holy shit. Okay, we didn't kill anything then.
Yep.
So, no animals were
harmed. Welcome to Nightfall Drives. Doug here, and today we're out with Neil in his 2007 Mazda MX5 NC. Start with, have a look around it with the owner and get to know it. I already have an NC MX5 similar to this, so straight to the drive today. There's not much point in poking around, but we'll find somewhere to stop. Hopefully you'd have just seen some nice arty shots where we find to pull over. But it's an interesting car, so it's a hardtop, obviously different to mine, and Neil's done an awful lot of work on it himself. Quite a sort of ambitious overhaul over the years, so thanks for bringing me out.
You're more than welcome.
Very familiar surroundings, but you've got a nice car play presumably in the...
Yeah, so upgraded all of that so that we can have the car play in there, which just kind of modernises the interior a little bit. I like it.
Yeah. So how long have you had it again?
I think 2018 is when I bought it, I think. It's just been pretty much rock solid. It's just maintenance, that, you know, just wear and tear that's going on with it. So otherwise I've had literally no problems with it. It's just a fantastic little car.
I think you were telling me it was the cheapest of its type at the time you bought it.
And when I bought it, in the country, it was the cheapest power retractable hardtop MX5 NC1 in the country. So it did need a little bit of work, and some of it was like bodywork. The paint was not the best. I think it had been sat outside for a long time. But mechanically, like, it had been serviced every year. That's kind of shone through. But I took it as a learning experience to sort of learn how to maintain a car and do as much of the mechanical stuff as possible. Each year, just do a little bit more. I've learned a lot.
But you've certainly taken on some more ambitious jobs than I would have done. I think that, it looks incredibly like pristine paintwork. I think you've done machine polishing and...
Hours. Like, it was probably... I don't know, like maybe half an hour per panel or something. I did it over at least 2 days to correct the paint. What I did was I ended up sort of polishing out all of the light scratches, and what that meant was you could then see the deeper scratches. So there's still a bit more to be done, but it's, I suppose you don't want to polish it too much.
Yeah. Obviously, you've got the angel eye lights, which is a unique mod. But to do that, it was quite involved, wasn't it?
So obviously to get the headlights out, you've got to take the bumper off, which is obviously the fantastic part of this car. So you take the bumper off, take the headlights out, put them in the oven to loosen the glue, take them apart, which is pretty scary, because I think brand new, they're like, is it like £350 or something each? So you loosen the glue, take the, you've got to drill it, fit it all, do all the electronics and this and that, and then put it all back in and hope to God that it works. I think it's quite a neat kind of look. It does modernise the front a fair bit as well. so
yeah, and that's what we're doing. Yeah, definitely, and additional visibility can't hurt on a low dark car like this,
100%.
As I know from experience.
Yeah, I do find that it seems that some people don't notice the car.
Yeah.
It's not that small, but yeah, so it definitely helps with that. And I like the way that it's all part of the same headlight as opposed to anywhere else. I think we keep going up here.
Yeah.
Sorry, so we may get lost. but we've got a satnav, so if we do get lost, we can find our way back.
Yeah, it's a lovely place to get lost. Is it in Yorkshire Wolds?
I think we go down here.
Okay. This is an ideal little car for these types of lanes.
Oh, 100%.
I think the MC is a really probably a great place to start with, I suppose, well, MX5s and sports car ownership. I've had a couple of Mark 1s and a couple of MCs. And they were a bit, I don't know if they were sort of seen as the... Or is it a disappointing car to start with by the market?
But I think people see it as the black sheep in a way. That people don't like the look of it. I don't know why. It genuinely grows on you, I think. And I like the way online they say that it looks like a boat. And it does have a bit of a boatish kind of look to it. I love it. I think there's so much charm. Yeah. And there's something about, you know, slightly older Japanese cars. I think the design language is really, really good. It's really in right now. So I think it's only getting better. It's maturing with age.
I was going to continue talking about the looks, but it's probably a good time to mention the suspension. So you recently sort of overhauled that.
It was mission creep, you know, or scope creep, I suppose you call it, where I was trying to replace these rubber gaiters around the struts, so I had to take the suspension off, and I found one of the springs had snapped just at the very top, and so obviously they needed to be replaced. So this has got the pristine suspension. I wanted to replace it like for like, because I quite like stock, I'm kind of one of those kind of guys. However, couldn't get the parts. I think they estimated it'd be at least 12 weeks to get them shipped over from, I guess, Germany. And so I just got the next best thing, which meant, and all of the options were, you had to lower the car. So I lowered the car the least amount, which I think was 3 centimetres.
It makes quite a difference.
It does, I mean, now, don't get me wrong, it looks incredible. But yeah, it is significantly lower, and it's a bit stiffer as well. So as we're going over some of these bumps, we might sort of leave the chair. It was pretty cool. So I did all that, and then after that, the rear brakes, the pistons were, one of them was seized. Holy s***.
Ooh.
Okay, we didn't kill anything then.
Yeah.
So no animals
were harmed. The making of this, I'm going to have to find the bleep button.
Yeah, I was going to say sorry for the swearing. Yeah, so I thought instead of just replacing the brake calipers, I would refurb them for fun, to learn, essentially. It was a bit involved. So I ended up having to replace the pistons completely because, the seals are broken, so there was rusty, all this kind of stuff. Just completely refurb them. And then I was like, well, I might as well do the front. they didn't need any pistons replacing, but I just changed all the seals, kind of refurbed them. And while I was there, I then replaced the brake light, because the brake hoses are rubber. To replace them with steel braided brake lines, the connectors for the end of the brake lines that went into the rubber hoses were completely seized, so I had to cut them and then had to make replacement sort of sections of the brake line, all this kind of stuff. It was a proper mission creep kind of job, but the brakes now are fantastic.
As we just saw.
Yeah, they are just a lot sharper, and yeah. There's a lot more confidence in them. And it's kind of fun to like brake heavily, I should say, in them, although I'm sure my wife doesn't like that.
I don't think you're not taking it on track or anything like that.
No, it is a bit old, so I don't know if it would like the stress of a track day. I mean, it'd probably be fine, but I've done so much maintenance on it recently, I just want it to chill for a bit.
That's what we're doing just now. It's a very slow turn.
That is the slowest turn I think I've ever seen.
Yeah.
But I guess it is Sunday driving.
Yeah. So. Yeah. Hard top versus soft top decision, I think, is partly the looks, but I guess it from what I can tell so far, this is more refined, bit of a quieter cabin.
Yeah, I mean, I've not had the soft top, but noise-wise, it's fine. They're not the quietest car, you know, so you do hear the engine noise on the motorway and this and that. But yeah, it's from factory, from new, I believe it had a slightly higher top speed because of the roof.
Right. Yeah.
Probably only a couple of miles an hour, though. I like it. It's best of both worlds in a lot of ways. And you can get a unit to modify it so it can automatically go up and down and at speed. I think it's called Smart Top or something, which I've not installed. I've not got that. But you can do that.
I think I maybe because of the Mark 1s, when I got my NCs, I did go for the soft top and then have an aftermarket hard top for the winter months, and then didn't really consider the folding hard top, to be honest, but I think they are a bit more expensive, I guess, compared to the soft top.
I think so, yeah. I think that one of the other differences, I think the boot lid is different. I guess it's just slightly smaller, and we don't have the storage behind the seats either, because obviously that's where the hard top goes. I mean, it's still got a decent amount of storage space. We've not had many problems, although we do fill it up when we go like on long journeys. So
And you're taking it on away for a few days, and you can use soft bags, and you can get quite a lot in.
I mean, we'd stick all the Christmas presents in there when we go to my parents at Christmas and this and that, and it just about fits in. So
what a spot.
Yeah.
Great find.
I mean, look at this. It's
look
incredible.
At that. Yeah. Well, while we're here, shall we have a quick look under the bonnet?
Sure.
Sorry. So you spent a lot of time in here.
Yeah, I replaced that recently as well.
Oh yeah.
Because that was like yellow, and that's they apparently fail. So I was like, that wasn't too bad. And then while I was at that, that's when I just changed the water pump, just because I always wanted to.
Yeah. I like the sticker actually for the air filter. I need to get one of those on there.
Yeah.
Yeah. Obviously, sort of Ford Duratec engine. This is the 2 litre.
2 litre.
Yeah.
2 litre sport option pack, I think, is what it's called. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Because it was 1.8 and 2 litre was available. So it's probably about 156 horsepower, I think, from some.
It's probably not that at the moment. I think it was originally something like that, yeah.
I think this is where the ambitions might, you know, these engines, you can do all sorts. You can obviously beat the BBR of mine. There's the 2.5 litre conversion, which
I would like to do if there's cause for it. I do fancy taking that on one day.
Yeah.
But the engine's got to blow for that to happen. You know,
well,
so
yeah. It's
drive it hard, I suppose. Maybe it'll happen. I don't know.
Yeah.
But I'd like to try. So if something went catastrophically wrong, that's what I would do. I don't see why it would, though, because they're super reliable, fantastic engines, you know.
Yeah. Yeah, you're on about, is it 116,000?
Something like that, yeah.
Yeah.
Creeping
yeah,
up. So. And as far as I know, the covers never actually come off the engine's not been apart. So
yeah, yeah.
So, you know, I think in America some of the cars do well over 200,000 miles. So
yeah, yeah. Well, I mean, this is a beautiful spot, but should we continue the drive?
Yeah. Let's crack on.
Let's do the roof.
Let's drive.
That's it. Pretty
yeah,
quick.
It's pretty good. Pretty neat.
Bristol ones with all the windows and the whole roof off, bloody lovely.
Yeah, yeah.
It does, on the motorway, if you've got the roof off, it does drink petrol a little bit.
Yeah, yeah.
So I probably wouldn't do it now. Can't see properly. Here we go.
Oh, look at that road. Engine to rev out all the way.
Yeah, it loves to rev. I think the problem is we just stuck to 60 miles an hour around here.
Yeah. Have you taken it abroad?
Abroad? I haven't, I was thinking about it. I just don't know, like, the level of difficulty it would add by having a right-hand drive car. Because I've only ever driven left-hand drive cars around Europe, rentals, and I don't know. So it's super tempting, but I don't know.
Yeah, I think the left-hand drive abroad is obviously a constant reminder of you'll be on that side. But I've taken the Mazda and the Lotus across to France and Belgium, and it's fine really.
Yeah.
I found, yeah, you just get used to it. There's always someone to follow. And it's quite exciting going to the tunnel or the ferry across. And
I do like the idea of going from your doorstep to your car to driving to your destination.
Yeah.
Like, I do really like that idea, and one way or another I would like to do it.
And it's worth it usually for the road to get over there, although I must say these are fantastic. It's lovely, quiet day as well. And somehow you don't seem to have many potholes here.
So, this is a really good road.
Yeah.
This is, when I first got in the car, I found this, and this was like my 60 mile an hour road for testing. Just because there's not much traffic and it's a really good surface, and it's 60 miles an hour, so it's as quick as you can go.
Yeah, good visibility as well. See the miles.
I mean, it's beautiful. Yorkshire in the summer, fantastic. For long journeys, it's actually surprisingly comfy.
Yeah.
I thought when I bought it that I wouldn't like to do long journeys in it, but I prefer doing long journeys in this than the Fiesta.
Yeah.
This is way more comfy. And, you know, it's way more comfy than it has any right to be.
Yeah.
The seats are really good.
Yeah.
Yeah, the suspension and everything, really good.
Yeah, seats are worth a mention. So it's a good feature in the Mark 1's seats. I have pretty good, and I've got on really well with these in mine as well.
Yeah.
But is it the height adjustable ones?
No, this doesn't. The NC1 doesn't have that.
No, of course.
It's okay for me, but I did install like some kind of lumbar support, some kind of like pump that you do your blood pressure test on. I don't know what it's called. It's got a weird name. Anyway, you just stick that in the back of the seat, and you've got lumbar support, which helps with the long journeys.
Yeah.
Sound like an old man.
Well, it's effectively your daily, isn't it?
Yeah, this is
your main car.
Yeah.
And the seats, lovely and comfortable, but the big difference NT1 and NT2 that I've had one of each. The high adjustable seat on the NC2, I've had to fit lowering brackets.
Because it automatically raises it.
The lowest it will go is not as low as an NC1. But I've fitted new brackets to the back of the seat, and it drops the back of the seat an inch or two. It makes a huge difference. The front of the seat's where it is, but obviously the back is. It feels a bit of a racier position as well, but. I don't think it's necessary in an NC1 really, unless you're very, very tall.
Yeah, I'm not very tall.
Is there anything else you think is worth mentioning? I don't think we've covered it, given justice to all the hard work you've done on it, but sometimes it looks fantastic.
Oh, thanks.
And it drives really well.
Yeah.
So I guess the next plans, well, maintenance, like you say, but maybe one day an engine mod.
Potentially, with the option of working from home, it doesn't matter if I have it on axle stands for a few weeks or months. It's been the best car I've ever had. It's just a joy to drive, and I love letting other people drive it and giving them the experience as well. It's just nice.
You were saying earlier, the key is to get one that's been mechanically looked after, and cosmetically you've cleaned it all up, and it was pretty not in great shape in that regard, but now it looks
filthy. And that was it, just clean it and just it made a world of difference. Surprisingly, I do find that people do kind of like look at the car. Sometimes when I park it, people actually are sort of eyeing it up and walking around it and stuff, so I've clearly got it to the right kind of spec.
You do find yourself looking over your shoulder walking away. But yeah, it's been a lovely day for a quick spin. Thanks very much, Neil.
You're very welcome. Anytime.
Really enjoyed it, and it's testament to the hard work you've been to, as I say, and thanks a lot for your time. Hopefully you've enjoyed the video, and give it a like and subscribe for more to come. Thanks a lot.
That's right.
That was it. So it's just a little robot voice to say, let's rock. Right, I love that.